Ladies and gentlemen, this is a...
Well, I'm going to make it known to West, to Eversource, whatever they want to call themselves, I'm not very happy with their stalled, stupid tactics.
With their conversation with them.
And if it wasn't for you guys, I would not give them this poll hearing.
Yep, we're all good.
Not that I have a problem with you guys, but you guys are terrible.
Well, not the poll, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen.
They're terrible.
We are expressing our frustration with interconnection agreements with the local utility, not that it's the engineer's particular issue, but if you could pass the word up, that'd be helpful. We actually had this conversation with the folks at Eversource in Boston as well, and they were like, don't yell at me, it's not us. I understand. So we're going to start off tonight with a poll hearing with regard to an extension of a new service over on Silver Lane. We're going to go over the Selectmen Administration's part of their budget, and then I think it would start, I want to start with a reminder that tomorrow, of course, is primary here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The polling is at the town of Sunderland at the elementary school with a start time of 7 a.m. and closing at 8 p.m. It's important to bear in mind, you've got to be enrolled at some point. You're either enrolled in a party or you're unenrolled, right? And it's really important to pay attention to the ballot this year. If you've paid attention to the news, the Secretary of State here has been saying the ballot is richer, fuller palette this year. It's a little confusing. There are more parties, more names. So please pay attention if you're participating tomorrow. And as far as the unenrolled voters go, you have the opportunity of taking the ballot, going through the process, and then declaring your unenrolled status at the end again. So again, tomorrow, 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. at the elementary school. And if you have not been confirmed as a registered voter in the town of Sunderland and you show up at the poll, please be polite if you're not on the rolls. We have a responsibility individually to simply not show up and say, what about me? There's a process, and that process, we've been talking about at these meetings, the Commonwealth's been talking about it for several months now. You have to be a registered voter in the town. So that said, if you find out for some reason, we got helpful staff down there, if you find out for some reason you're not on the rolls, there's probably a reason for it, and you'd want to pay attention to fixing that come the next election. Okay, first up,
if I could just add one thing, Mr. Sure. Chair, there's a new party. Because in the last election, 3% of the vote went to this mm-hmm. party called the United Independent mm-hmm. Party. If a lot of unenrolled voters think of themselves as independent voters,
right. Good point.
You may have inadvertently said or at some point declared that you're an independent voter. If you declared some, you may be, if you are enrolled as a United Independent Party voter, you can only pick up a United Independent Party ballot.
Right.
So, and I can, across the state, there was 20,000 people that were listed as United Independent Party members that withdrew that designation to change it to either unenrolled or some other thing. So that could be something that you find tomorrow, that somehow you were put in as United Independent Party. So that's not a, if you wanted to take a Democratic or Green Party or Republican, you would not be able to do that.
Right. I think, Tom, you raise a good point. We used to, many people who were unenrolled refer to themselves in either dialogue or in practice as being independent. And after the last national election, there is a party in Massachusetts with that name. And if you checked off independent, guess what? You might well be affiliated with that party. So please pay attention to it. Unenrolled, you can still play by those sets of rules, pick up your ballot, go through the process, and declare your unenrolled status again. I think that's what Galvin was really wired up about over the last 6 months. He's like, oh, man, a bunch of people think they're independent, right. And now there's a real party.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks, Tom. So we're going to start off with a poll hearing. But before the poll hearing, how's Eversource's business?
So far, so good.
Hire more distributed generation people.
Agreed.
Okay, good. That said, it's been, you know, we've been at this a couple, 3 years now, bites at this apple. And I understand the pressures associated with the distributed generation. But boy, has it been like, makes my hair fall out. I guess it's probably the best way to put it.
Yep.
You know the feeling exactly on the receiving end. See the rep for Western Mass, Jerry retired. He's moved on to another area. He used to be our guy.
Jerry is still with us.
Yeah.
He is in system projects. You'll probably see more of him.
Okay.
He's not out of the fold completely yet.
Good.
He's still very much active and on the books.
Good. I hear him every now and then winning tickets on WRSI, so it's like Jerry. Yeah, you know, exactly right. All right. So we've got a petition in front of us. We have a process here. We're notified by the petitioner. We have posted as a public hearing. It looks like we've got the attachment here. And it's when, oh God, number two font.
Yeah.
That's what the 19th of February, this went in originally. We have a posting here with our attachment that was in the Greenfield Recorder. Legal notice. David, I know you got a cold. You want to just plow through the bigger version?
Yes. All right. Poll hearing. The town of Sunderland will be conducting a poll hearing on Monday, February 29th, 2016 at 6:30 p.m. in the Sunderland Town Office Building, 12 School Street, Sunderland, Mass. 01375. In response to a poll hearing petition from Eversource/Wamico. Reason, to install two new poles labeled 36/52 and 36/51, beginning approximately 175 feet southerly from existing pole 36/53 for the purpose, I suppose I should shut that out since it's like all capitalized there, I don't know why they do that, to provide electrical service to a new building on Silver Lane. Board of Selectmen, Town of Sunderland.
Okay, so we've got our public notice as a petitioners. This is a chance where you get to tell us what it is exactly. It looks like we have our drawing. Mm-hmm. And we don't have a little flippy thing, but it looks like it's an extension of an existing line by two pole sets.
It is.
And no street crossings. No crazy guying, bracing, corners.
Nope, it's actually a very straight line. Mm-hmm. We have out there our existing facilities stop shy of where the new facility for the kitchen garden is to be constructed.
Mm-hmm.
In order to give them proper service, we need to extend facilities along the roadway to reach them and supply an adequate supply of electricity.
Okay. I'm going to have to dig back through the memory bank. Tom, don't we have a forced main leaving the kitchen garden going parallel along the road, the tie-up? We did a sewer extension. Right?
Yeah,
was it
so,
2.5-inch? Was along that lines, but I'm thinking it's on that side of the street.
Yeah.
We know it's essentially it's effectively a single service extension, and I would ask maybe coordination with George Emery and the drawings to make sure we don't accidentally find that pipe.
Yeah.
Well, you would hope.
Yeah, would hope.
It would put in a dig safe, but.
Right.
I've known stranger things to happen with Eversource.
But it came to mind that, again, that was an extension of a couple hundred feet, as I recall, to get up to the gravity side.
Yeah, standard practice before any work is done in the field. If we have to put a shovel in the ground for something small like an anchor or a telephone pole, we always have an active dig safe for the job.
Okay.
If there's an issue, something we should check into, I can follow up with the roadway super and make sure that if any prints that you guys might have that will show where that is, that we obtain those before.
Yep.
Poles are installed.
As I recall, as part of that process, there was a set of prints, and it was tied to the deed, as I recall.
Yeah, you may have to.
Right? We recorded it as part of it.
But you may want to talk to the wastewater treatment plant.
Those guys.
Okay.
Okay. Any questions of abutters? Questions of the public in general? If not, questions of the members of the board?
No, that's pretty straightforward. Service extension.
Tom, what do you think?
I'm familiar with the spot, so.
In my opinion, I think we should do the same thing Eversource does to us. Sit on it and wait until they go away. That's what they're doing with us with our interconnection agreement with them. They're just trying to make, but.
So the, just, I want to address that. What specifically, is it something for the town?
It's a municipal solar project.
We're trying to get solar PVs.
So if I go back and relay information to the DG group that's in our office, I work for the engineering division. We work in the same building, but I don't specifically work directly for DG. If there's a project that I can kind of focus that effort back on to, you know, make sure that that one comes to the forefront, or at least they understand that you guys are upset, I'd like to take some of that information back with me before I go back to the office tomorrow.
Dave, you want to give them the specifics?
Yep, we're doing two municipal solar PV projects, one over behind the safety complex and one next to the school. So, and we went through this, it was all approved. And then unfortunately, the contractor went out of business. Okay. So we finally get the whole thing rolling again. And then, and it was actually based, we actually scaled it back even a little bit too, and didn't do any kind of expansions to it to make sure that we didn't have any problems going forward. But now it's kind of bogged down, to say the least, so.
I'll say there's a little bit of, it feels like on this end there was a little bit of bait and switch when it was reviewed as single projects, and then we were coached to bring it together as a bundled review.
The
bundled review escalated to a two-circuit review, not necessarily exclusive to our projects, but a larger review of the capacity of the area's infrastructure to support a much bigger piece of tie-in. So it feels a little bit like bait and switch. We're talking about under 300 kW total between the two spaces on circuits that are pretty robust, as well you know. And now we're being directed to come in behind the meter. And that's kind of adds another layer of complexity, as well as DTTS, et cetera, et cetera. So it's turned into an area, frankly, like it's a boil in a saddle while you ride the horse. It's not a lot of fun.
So Eversource is a public, bottom line, Eversource is a public utility, okay? They may think they hold whatever they hold right now, but there are other communities that are doing it. There's other customers that are going through the same thing right now. And if they want to play, we will play. We are not averse to playing with them. And if they want to be dragged through the mud because they won't let towns or help towns or and people try to make it more economic for them to do business like the business that we have in today, if they don't want to do that, that's fine. But they understand if they want to be dragged through the mud, they want to play in the mud. We're very used to playing in the mud, and we'll take them right through the mud. I'm right now I'm there, and I get emails from the town administrator, and if it was me, we'd already be going through the mud, because you guys are terrible. To do what you, we've been, how long is this now, David? Over a year?
Oh, yeah.
Over three.
Okay, so if they want to play, that's fine. And they can tell us all they want about Podunk Station and about 15 megawatts coming offline and this and that. If they want to play, that's fine. But they're a big company, but they also have to live with public perception.
Absolutely. I agree with that. I will pass on the frustration I hear.
So guess what? Right now, my voice can be heard wherever the FCAT's being thing. It'll go on YouTube. And we're going to talk about what a lousy company Eversource is. And after their performance during some of the storms, I think there's a lot of people out there say, you know what, Eversource is. All gas prices, fuel prices are all going down. Electric rates haven't come down. Have you seen electric rates come down? Your fuel charge and every distribution charge, those aren't coming down that quick. Hey, they want to play, we can play. And if they want to get the state legislators involved, they're just itching to. They're asking us to please come forward. We'll do that too. And we want to go talk to the Secretary of the Utilities, we'll go talk to Secretary of Utilities. They're supposed to be out there for the ratepayers and the public thing. That's who we talk to. I'm just so, you guys are, and you guys are, if they, sometimes they'd come in, I would vote no. I want to vote yes, just because it's for the farm table, or I mean for, like, but if it was, whatever. Thank you, Scott.
Oh, no trouble.
For my tirade.
It's all right. It's a very frustrating position.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other discussion with respect to the application in front of us?
Yeah.
I'd just like to make note that please make sure you put in there what I think about Eversource. In case anybody 20 years want to go read what I think of Eversource. Maybe that's why they changed their name. Try a new name because with the other file, too big.
Okay. No other discussion on the poll hearing?
Yeah.
If not, is there a motion to grant as this petition has been presented?
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. This again is Silver Lane. This is a two-pole extension on the same side of the road. No crossings, no bracing. And we're going to pay attention to, we'll work with the sewer plant operators about that. They have that same thing on file as well. Okay. Motion is made and seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That's your chance.
I'm not going to do it
today. 3-0, please. In all seriousness, pass that on.
Well,
it's an area of friction. Okay?
Great. Thank you for your time.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Nice kitchen garden. Good sriracha, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
Yep.
Every Sunday morning.
That's right.
Okay. Before we go on to the Selectment Administration budget presentation, let's talk about the minutes of the 22nd. And then do our updates beforehand.
Motion on the minutes.
Those are really short. And I was like,
wrong side.
Damn. This was our appointment with administration talking about the elementary school budget. And there's, as we use the word tension and pressure, there is real pressure on the town's resources with the budget that's been presented by the administration. Again, we have revenue growth of under $200,000 a year, and we have an application in front of us for well over that with just this one department. So that's something that we'll continue to work with.
Motion.
We have a motion. Is there a second,
second
for the minutes? Motion's made and seconded to accept the minutes of the 22nd. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, 3-0, please. Okay, anything else quick we can go through? We have to actually just put on notice. Let me jump down the agenda one more time here. We have to just simply put on notice that we've received the land acquisition request for Assessor's Map Lot 1, Map 1, Lot 42. This is a contiguous piece. This is a DCR request. This is a contiguous piece of property. This is a piece of property that would make contiguous a large piece of state DCR and DCR land that would be the west side of Mount Toby headed down toward Route 63. Now, our process here is we're being asked to do the 120-day waiver, correct?
To waive it to 60 days.
We have a correspondence in front of us. And again, this is a 75 plus acre parcel owned by the Gunn family, and they're looking to sell that to the state. This is adjoining Mount Toby State Forest property, and the map is here. I looked at the larger map downstairs. This one's busy, and it really does make for a large chunk of continuous woodland throughout there. You know the space? Yeah.
Let me just look at the map real quick. It's the field across the Hussies, behind the Hussie house.
Yeah.
It was actually sold to Franklin Land Trust first.
Yep.
Right.
It's the trust first, and now this is essentially title transfer over. Right. Take it that way. So that said, in this case here, we have a request to reduce it to 60 days. Is there any discussion about reducing that to 60 days? And we ended up having another hearing accordingly.
Conservation's been notified. They're going to take it up under their agenda tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm. So this, again, is a property that was held privately, now is held by the trust, and now looking to be reverted to the state, to the DCR.
We need to wait for them to get back to us, first, right?
I was going to schedule it for action on the 7th after we hear back from Conservation.
Okay.
Right. Sounds good.
Tell me something, you're neck of the woods, right?
I would just say one thing. In my opinion, this parcel property is probably one of the nicest, except for a certain thing up by Whitmore Whitmore Pond. It's one of the nicest views. It's a gorgeous location. I would hope that the DCR makes it known that this is now public land and welcomes people onto that piece of property. I think it's absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous piece of property. I would hate that if it just becomes public land that's never known and it's never used.
Good point. There's just something bottling it up for the sake of it. No, you raise a good point.
It is an absolutely gorgeous piece of property. There's some beautiful. If you walk back there during on sunsets, it's some of the most spectacular views that you would see. And I bet you very few people have been back there because there are no trespassing signs. Right. Yeah, no trespassing, but there's signs about bald eagles and stuff.
Maybe we look at getting a trail put up through there to connect to something else.
So it's not no trespassing, but
There's a trail that goes up there.
Is there an existing one?
Seven, yeah.
Oh yeah.
Then you can also access it from.
Come down from the sugar camp.
Is it? It may not be marked though, right?
What?
It might not be blazed right now.
It's an old town road and stuff.
Mark it up as an actual.
There's
trail.
There's an old maple syrup. There's a maple.
It's maple grove
up there.
There's
a maple. It's gorgeous.
Big swamp up there.
Yeah, it's absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, that's the nice thing of the contiguous piece of it now. You've got a
big, you look nice, at the full-on map. That's a big swath of land. You tie them together.
That connects all
for animal movement and species
right
movement.
Right over to Gun Mountain. with state
it does.
And then it goes a little bit to the south of that, I guess. Yeah.
So I would say that if in the vote, I would just encourage DCR to make it known and with signage. I mean, we've done that before with DCR taking. So I would hope that we would use that maybe as a second access into Mount Hood as well.
That might tie in right down to the river too with
almost
with that last piece that was marked.
Not quite.
That who just passed away.
Mr. Goodyear.
Goodyear, right.
Yeah, but if you go to Whitmore's property, like the gun farm's under APR or something now, right?
61A.
I thought someone bought that. The trustees or is there,
that was this piece they bought.
Did American Farmland Trust buy that?
Still 61A?
Still 61A wood.
Mm-hmm.
Even the farmland proper?
The parcel we're speaking of is under 61A wood, and it was bought by Franklin Trust. Nothing's changed at this point.
Got it.
But the farm, the actual farmland, isn't that held by American Farmland Trust or something like that?
You're talking across the road, headed toward the river.
Yeah, and if it is, that ties right in down to the river.
Yep. May raise a good point, Bruce.
You check the map. Like, we get that map downstairs and see if it's an APR. I don't remember off the top of my head.
It was recent. I would say it was the last 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
To Tom's point, maybe, Cherry, as this process unfolds and if it continues to go forward, we could ask if the DCR has a master plan on file that we can, it's a public document. They must know something of what they want to do with it, meaning the whole area.
Yeah. Part of it, the UMass is separate.
Mm. UMass is separate.
Of course, we want a separate plan.
That's a different parcel. Right. Yeah.
Simple question we could ask. Okay. So the request in front of us is about a reduction in the time required for public comment, and this is what they're referring to as our announcement and the waiver of the 120-day notice.
That's fine. I just think, to me, if we're going to take land like that, we should use land like that, because that, like I said, it's beautiful land.
It's not being a taken, Tom. It's not a taken.
Yeah.
It's a voluntary sale.
It's a sale. Well, DCR is buying it with monies that were raised off from hunting.
Mm-hmm. A land taking and a voluntary sale.
Sure.
Two different things.
And it's been pointed out, this is actually going from Franklin Land Trust.
Yeah. They already sold to the land trust, and now they're just shifting it over,
acting as a bridge.
And that's very common. That's why the Franklin Trust and others, Franklin is specific for that reason, that they have monies available while the state may not.
And they can act as effectively a bridge holder or a bridge loan or
exactly.
placeholder, whichever term you'd like to use. Okay, there's another discussion. If there's not, is there a motion to grant the waiver as has been requested? And then we'll schedule our hearing accordingly.
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm not in a grumpy mood tonight, really.
It's okay. 3-0. Okay. Now we'll come over to our selectman administration budget presentation. I don't want to tie up assessors too long. Thanks so much for coming in. I appreciate that. Those are two pieces of business we could check off the list while we go on about the budget. Okay. So, Sherry, how do you want to handle this? This is your first time around with us.
Yeah, we'll let Teresa go first.
Start with the assessors. Then you can go. Right. Thanks for coming in, Teresa.
So, there isn't too much that's different from any previous year, but the question I have is the notes that I had in my computer when Lee was here. There was a note, we have a category that's computer support, which is Patriot Properties and Cartographic, which has the GIS hosting.
Yep.
There was a note in there that said $300 to be paid from the technology account in future years. So my question is, do you know anything about that and when that would start? I called her and asked her. She said there was something Margaret was supposed to have brought up before the board.
Okay. So the note says we'll be moving some money inside of the assessor's budget in support of that contract through the technology line?
It says verbatim, $300 to be paid from the technology account in future years for this computer support.
Rather than the expense.
Last year's budget.
Okay.
I wonder
so
if...
I don't know what that entails or if that exists or...
It looks like you've got in here, you've got in the detailed presentation, Bruce, you may not have the account number by number, but it looks like under computer support 541000 or 141541000, you got like 5,800, 7,500, back to 5,800, and it looks like there may be some of those monies available inside that line to feed the license, I think is what I'm hearing.
Well,
My interpretation is that it should be paid from the technology account and not from that line. Is that what you're asking?
That's what the note said. So that's what I was trying to clarify. What is this technology account, and where are you planning on paying money out of that?
I think
to offset this.
Yep. Right. I think if we go up to, and thanks for clarifying that. I think you're right. Sherry, if you go through and get to the select board, you get the technology, of which there's $1,500 up to $6,000 now. A portion of that was going to be for
$300 of that would be for their support in
future
years.
That makes sense.
So would we reduce that line by the $300, or have you done that already?
I haven't done that because I didn't know when this would go into effect. What I wanted to request was that $300 be put into general expenses to allow me to attend more professional development opportunities. Because right now there's some I'd like to go to, but there isn't enough money in the budget because that's just general expenses. And I created a sheet of what I spent last year, and over half of it, $1,500, and I spent $750 between the UMass school and different conferences. And I found it very beneficial because I was able to recoup some money for the town because I learned different things.
Different
things. I think it's definitely worthwhile. And there's different conferences throughout the state. Like there's one coming up in the spring that I think would be very beneficial, but it's $80.
Sure.
And I don't really have that in the budget. So if I want to go, I have to spend my own money to go.
Right.
Well,
what
I would suggest, Teresa, is that the town has money sometimes available for training. So before you do anything, I would talk to Sherry to find out if there's money available.
If there's something for that, that would be great because I do want to keep doing that. And I've been going to all these different, it's the Assessors Association, and they have it throughout the state. And a lot of people don't want to drive. I don't mind driving. Like this one that's coming up is in Devens. It's just...
Yeah. Will that be in fiscal 16? Is that for fiscal 16 or 17, the one that's coming up?
The one that's coming up is 16. It's April.
Oh, April?
Yeah.
Okay. So But I'm looking for the future, you know, because I'd like to keep going to the UMass school.
Right.
But there's also these conferences. There's one in the fall, there's a winter, there's a spring. And then there's different, like there's Hampshire County that I've been going to, which we're not in that, but they'll let you go.
Oh, nice.
You know, you pay slightly more because you're not a member, but not that much.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everything I go to, I meet new people and there's new resources. And right. new, it's just a good way to
networking
stay current.
For the...
Yeah, a lot of networking. And I've been going to this Franklin County Association. They've been having just like brainstorming sessions. Roundtable, I guess they call it.
Yeah.
I've been doing that, and we hosted one over here at the library.
Nice.
So I'm trying to stay really active, but
good.
So that's why I was thinking if that, so it really wouldn't be more if the technology
shifting.
Paid that, right. then I could take that 300 towards the, unless there's another account that I'm not aware of for.
I think we're talking about the mechanics that are going to allow us to make sure that Patriot's covered, as well as ensure that there's monies available for the training, whether it's through the Selectman's professional development line, or if that line covers piece of that license, right. frees it up. I think the mechanism is pretty straightforward. It's already budgeted. It's a matter of moving
shifting.
It or moving it through. So what I'm seeing is an aggregate increase here for assessors of $692, $687 total?
Yeah, and one is just something out of our control is that the map updates are going up a little bit. That's nothing I can control. That's just the cost.
Yep.
It's been level for quite a few years, and I emailed them to ask, and so that's going up slightly. They're not going up on their web hosting, but they are going up on the actual maps. That's the only thing that's really increasing. And we're still in the contract for Mayflower through 17, so mm-hmm. that... really the only difference.
And I was reading the wrong line. It's actually $1,395. I was a line below that. Questions of Teresa on the request that's presented, right? I see assessor salary, $86. Administrative assistant. Again, these are going to come forward. These will be massaged as we get a recommendation from the personnel committee. $859. I see... assessor's expense, $300. We were just talking to that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then tax maps, another $150.
Correct.
And again, that's contractual. They're going up.
Mm-hmm.
Questions?
No questions.
Bruce, what do you think?
Pretty straightforward.
Tom?
Okay. So, Teresa, with respect to the continuing ed and professional development, work through the mechanisms with Sherry. And again, I think Margaret's note, and thank you, Margaret, for if you see this somehow, and thanks for leaving the note in there for more than one story about other notes tucked away in places, placeholders in the budget process. And it may be that simply comes right out of the technology line already. Okay?
Okay.
Great. Any questions for us? When are tax bills due?
When are they due? April 1st. Tax rate's $14.66. Water district 60 cents. Anything else you
want to
know?
No, it's all good. This is where it's a chance.
Water district, right?
Just a note, I've been working a lot with this cartographic and they've been fantastic the GIS.
Good.
Nice.
That's good.
And I've updated our website so you can get property cards on there. They did have a property card previously, but it didn't have the sale price or assessed value.
Mm.
So I called them up, asked them if they could put that on the card. The guy worked with me. Within 15 minutes, he had it fixed.
Nice.
And I said, what do I do to populate all the cases? It's done. And so, and if we ever want to add any layers,
I emailed
DeFranco, and he said, if we do it at the time we update our maps, mm-hmm. there's no extra cost.
Oh, nice.
Included, as long as it's formatted.
Yep.
If we want to do it interim, there's be a cost, which I don't know why we would do that, because we could do it free. But if we did need to for some reason, there's like a $300 to $500 charge.
Nice.
And then if we have data that's not formatted, they could do that for us for a fee, mm-hmm. anywhere from $2,000 to $1,000, depending on what it is.
Okay.
Which we don't really have anything at this moment, but it's just something to know. If you want anything added to the map layers, it's possible.
Mm.
Right. And if we get it formatted, it's there's no extra charge to have it added.
We just had that opportunity earlier tonight during the poll hearing. We know there's a force main on that property.
That's right.
So if that's some, you know, if there's something like that you want to do,
just,
as long as it's formatted and we do it when the, which is at the beginning of the year when the mapping goes in.
Okay.
I send all the updates in. there wouldn't be any charge. So, like, if we want to do that for next January, as long as I know ahead, I can just ask them and they'll do it.
Perfect.
We should have a water, a sewer, right. Electric water, layer.
Sewer. It's already on there, I think.
A lot of it should be, I would think.
Yeah, sewer, but I'm not sure about the water.
The water.
The water's on there.
Okay, so, you know, anything else you want to do? Because right now there's the zoning.
Yep.
As the overlays, and I went and updated all that zoning, so all that's current.
Nice.
With the overlays and stuff, so.
Can you overlay the conservation land, too, on it?
We probably could if we had.
But really, as long as we got the data, we can put anything on there. APR.
Yeah. Well, it's already marked with chapter lands already.
That should be on there, yeah.
It is already on there.
Yeah.
But if there's something else you want, you know, they're willing to work with us, so.
Nice.
Very,
it's a great tool.
Well, keep the pressure. Don't be too friendly. Keep the pressure on them. Remember, they're still vendors.
Yeah, no, they're very cooperative. So, just something to know.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much, Bruce.
I got to say, is that computer system, you know, where you get online, mm-hmm. you can look up the parcels, the owners. Mm-hmm. Very, very nice.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. It took a long time to get there, but it's nice it's rolled out.
Yeah.
Good points. And again, thanks for all your work, Teresa. Appreciate it. Okay, Sherry, what do you do next?
What I did is I prepared a brief summary by section so I can go over that and then answer any questions the board has as we kind of go along.
So start right at the top.
One starting at the top with select board. There's a increase of 2.2% over last year, and that reflects an increase in contracted service. We have a proposal from the Veterans Memorial Committee for ground maintenance. They're asking for $2,500 this year. The budget last year was $990. We've had a slight decrease in mowing. I put it out to bid and it came in $2 under last year's.
Over a 3-year period,
holding our own
there.
Yep. The next section, accountant, there's an increase of 5.6% over last year's numbers, and that's reflected in the contracted services provided by FERCOG and software maintenance.
Is it excluded the software maintenance, and does this reflect the continued number of hours?
11 hours under the current agreement with the COG for accounting services.
Okay. Are they getting pretty settled in now?
Yeah, things are going well.
That was a concern not too long ago.
Yep, no, things are going well. Susan and Brian are working together really well. She has some help from Catherine as well. She's looking at presenting an increase in hours that Catherine is providing to assist.
Excellent.
Excellent. Oh, to get away from exclusively the payroll function and actually help on the
treasurer collector side is so busy, and she has a lot of duties and responsibilities with the HR functions of the town that's very time consuming. So I think it might be justified to give Catherine a couple hours more. The next line would be collector treasurer. There's a slight increase in the postage budget. I believe it was $694, and that's increased cost, not really increased mailings, and that's for all departments as well, not just the collector treasurer.
So it's going up right across. We'll see that in a couple of different places.
Yeah,
just like a postage. Yeah.
Town clerk Wendy's not feeling well, so she's not here tonight, but that one's level funded.
Yeah, I have her justification if you want to hear it. Basically, the major one that's going up is the elections, and we have the old old cycle.
That time,
right?
This year is going to be 3 elections versus the 2, plus there's going to be the whole way right now to do voting. If you, let's say Bruce wasn't going to be here during an election, and he knew he wasn't going to be here, he could put in for an absentee ballot, and he could do that absentee ballot and send it in, and it'd be fine. Now, but theoretically, if you take an absentee ballot, you're not supposed to be driving around town. You're not supposed to be seen in town because you could have voted. And I guess it's kind of an arcane law, but...
Sure.
Anyway,
it's a throwback.
It is. But they are changing it, and they're going to have what they call kind of like open voting. Mm-hmm. So there is, the town clerk is going to put extra money in there. So mm-hmm. basically it sounds that even if you can actually go vote ahead of time.
Okay.
So that's a new law that's being changed. Salary is basically increased, which is in line with what happens with the rest of the town employees. And that's about it. Everything else is basically level funding.
Yeah, if you look at our sheets that go way back. Bruce, you got one that goes back to 9 also back there? 2009, the spreadsheet goes back to? Yeah, if you look at every 4 years, it goes up, tick. There's a big jump, and then a drop back down. If you look at 09, there's 11,000, 10, 6. And you got a state election.
No, it makes sense. The more elections you have.
Yep. Just go up and down, up and down, up and down. So
everything else is basically is the same.
Okay. Okay. Thanks,
Tom. The town clerk wasn't feeling well, plus she'll be up early tomorrow morning with the election.
It's a long day, yeah.
Are you reimbursed for some of those elections?
Doesn't
can't answer that. I'm not sure.
Special election, if it's a special election,
makes sense. They'll pay, but these aren't special
right,
elections.
Right, I realize that.
What the state does do is they pay for the programming of the ballot machines.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So there is some help with that.
Okay. So next up, we're at 7 boards and committees. Sherry, looks like they're dead level.
Funded there.
Okay.
Town buildings, for the most part, is level funded. There were slight increases in the highway garage and PC, PSC.
Are those driven mainly by energy?
Energy. However, we did get a good price for fuel oil. Mm-hmm. We locked in earlier. And right now, we're in the process. I'm working with a broker on the electrical supply rates. Our mm-hmm. contract with, I believe it's Constellation.
Yep, Constellation, yep.
Is up in October. So we're paying, I think it's 16 cents a kilowatt hour now. So I think that's going to be coming down as well.
That's good.
Sure. So I think there's going to be some
a little reprieve. Again, I think that was a 5-year deal.
Yeah.
I think we wrote it in for 5 years as our provider, not our distribution guys.
So that's in the works too. We're looking at every place we can to save
all the
money.
Corners.
Absolutely.
So that's there is 1.6, but again, you're talking about $250 in one line.
Yeah.
That's a library building operating expense, and then there's $2,000 under public safety, and if we get some follow up with that, some more detail would be helpful. I know it's in here, but it's not coming to my head right away.
Okay.
Go ahead, Tom.
So I'm just looking at total general government.
Mm-hmm.
The number that doesn't make sense.
Total general government, an increase of 4.9.
Right. Well, if I'm just looking, I see 547, 534. Yeah. That's 15, not 24.
Oh yeah. Oh, I see. Going from.
So if you said 547, 594 minus 534, 543, that's $13,051. As I don't.
Right.
Good catch.
Yeah, I'll take a look at that.
Something probably got changed and then
got lost in translation.
So when I do a quick, that's 13,051, and if you divide it by the.
Yeah,
it's 534.
I'll take a look at that.
543. Yeah.
It's a little Excel
tweak. Yeah.
Okay. So that 4.9 looks like it's artificially inflated based on the spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And with respect to, and again, Chair, this is your first time running through this with this town, but that's not to say you don't have a year or so doing municipal budgeting.
Yeah.
Anything in this process that jumps out that could be improved, or you can noodle through that as we go forward,
and I'm learning. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
So I got 2.44%.
Okay.
Okay,
I'll take a look at that. Make sure we get everything up to snuff.
Total bit. Piece. No, treasure collector is not here. We did police. We did fire. We did highway. Library, schools, we should have benefits and insurance would be our last category, right? And then debt.
Let me see, I have town inspectors.
Town inspectors, I'm sorry, you're right.
The building expense is increased to reflect the need for new building code manuals for 2015.
Oh, yeah, they're being updated this year.
Yeah.
So this is a one-time purchase?
Right.
Well, it's triennial, but still. You know if it's a subscription base? We're getting the big books, obviously, the big blue books still
right,
show
and,
up.
And Joe did mention tonight if we join the ICC, we can get a reduced rate.
Okay.
I think it's about $100 to join, so we'll look into that.
Is that for two copies of everything? Because I added numbers up and I only got like $350.
That is.
It might be cool. One for the.
Well, there's also for commentaries that wasn't included in the prices that you looked at.
What do you mean? You mean like a?
It's a different, yeah. TAs. And then there's like the energy code.
No,
and
that was yeah, that book there, I think.
Let me look and see. I will double check.
He's asking for under the expense under this detail submission. He's looking for an additional $700. And it's the 8th edition building code. He's got here for the justification.
Yep.
He's got building and energy.
You got 5 books.
Yeah.
What's that?
But you're right, Bruce. If you look at them right across, it looks like it's 2 sets.
Yeah,
yeah, if you do the
think,
math.
Yeah.
I'll get clarification how many
whether sets. Whether it's one set for the office or one set for each inspector, I'm not quite sure. Can deal with the alternate. Still, we need a set for the office.
Yeah,
well, that's a good
set
catch.
Set for the office, I
right.
mean, you
know. Okay.
I know on the NFPA side, there's the hard copies, the handbooks. There's a variety of things. And then there's the subscription for what they call the tentative interim amendments, the things that roll out during the cycle. So I would,
does that come with online access, too?
It comes with it as well.
Yeah. It's easier to get a book.
You have to have hard copies.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I understand you have to have hard copies, but in addition to hard copy, because I would think that...
And this year's July 1st would be... July 1st is the new building codes come out.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's easy with a book. You can...
Well, if you're doing a keyword search, there's nothing like a digitized version.
Yeah. I realize that.
It's really like that.
Some of them refer to other sections.
Oh, I get that. Yep. Well, my point is that we should have both.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
True.
Yeah. I would think, but just a question.
Yeah. No, it's a good point.
I mean, the nice thing about books is they don't need batteries.
That was the hardest test I ever took.
What?
Construction supervisor. It was 3 hours for 150 questions, and I took 2 hours and 59 minutes and 38 seconds. I mean,
it's detail.
It's
not easy. Not easy stuff.
I won't make a comment on that.
And it was multiple choice.
Yeah.
I know. I did. I'm not saying
he's a top. I know most people don't pass on the first try.
What's that?
Most people don't pass on the first try.
I know.
So that's 700, and that's it for building, right?
Yep.
Annual inspection, 0, so that rolls up 3.3. And then other protections? There's 0 again.
Yep.
Again, civil defense, animal control. Crossing guards, just in case. Okay.
The next one would be health and sanitation.
Okay.
There's a slight increase in the solid waste district assessment. And the landfill monitoring testing is down. We completed some required testing. And so that dropped the cost there by $450. So that's a good thing.
That testing now is still being done by the Solid Waste District?
Yes.
Yeah. It was a good catch on Jan's part. Everything else is level down there?
Everything else
I
is
see
level.
I see over here in the Board of Health clerk agent, I see a percentage that carried through even though it's 0.
Okay. Get that.
Yeah. Yeah. Riverside Cemetery, is that is that a contract mowing?
Yeah.
Same guy that does?
Yep. Yeah, and you know, it's a... the seasonals are the really difficult parts of that. The fall cleanup and then again the spring cleanup.
And we carry those apart.
Not that you don't necessarily understand that. It's the quarterly the 2.5 quarters really that they're down there maintaining. That's what this drives at. But there's it takes a couple of seasons for a company to kind of get the gist of it. There's, as you well know, there's a lot of stuff, not just in that particular cemetery, but all cemeteries, the care that's required to not bash stones, and et cetera. Okay. Library we saw, schools, benefits and insurance. It's where we get clobbered by healthcare costs.
Yeah, that's the big driver there. It's up 5%. The other insurance that's provided by Maya is up 2.5% there. Medicare is payroll driven. A lot of these are fixed. There's not a whole lot.
So payroll driven, this is the double-edged sword of either having staff increases or hours increases. Of course, there's a proportionate contribution that comes in subsequent years.
Right. So that's that.
Go ahead, Bruce.
You know, I think when you look at the llama one used to be done by town employees.
Yep.
And it went out for contract for services, same with wastewater treatment, the contract for services. The savings shows up, you know, like the lawnmower. I don't think we could do the lawnmower for what we pay.
$3,000? Probably not.
And also, you know, for the town lawnmower. But in the benefits, too, he's saving a ton of money in the benefits.
Yeah. Right, because you're not and
that's,
human resources. And
that's a cost that keeps going on and on. Less employees you have.
Yep. No, you raise a good point. A lot of people aren't tuned in to that that soft cost or indirect costs.
Yeah, it's a killer.
Yep. Good point. So miscellaneous and reserve, it looks like you've got $500 for the COG assessment.
Yeah, the COG assessment is up a little bit. South County, I'll let them speak to their own. They'll be in, I believe, on the 14th. I'm just waiting to hear back from
Senior
Marley.
Center? Or, yeah. Okay, good. How was SCEMS level from last year? Oh, it's a little, a little tick on the level. Okay.
They'll be in next week, SCEMS. So.
Okay. Contractual obligation with respect to treatment plant. Again, this was the 10-year, for the first 10 years, we've ever had an escalator inside there.
And the sludge removal also includes 75% of the Franklin County Solid Waste District assessment.
Oh, good. Right, right. Okay. That's really kind of the big, that's their big contributor to helping us.
Right. It's $8, so. Yep. And the good news is debt and interest is down 19% or $67,726 because the Frontier renovation and the elementary school debt is paid. And
so if, go ahead, Tom.
I guess I don't know what to say about the elementary budget.
The budget requests.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think that they have. Right. It's right now. It says 100. It's up 146,212.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was up 2. I thought it was up 214.
It's 246.
Didn't they tell us 214?
I thought it was 246.
For some reason.
Oh, is that because it's transportation? Is that one?
Let's see if I have my hard copy.
Shortfall. 219.
Yeah, 219. You said they're up 219.5. How come we list 146?
Is transportation
because transportation is out is separate.
Separate line item.
If you add them together, Tom, that should come out.
So you're saying add the 146 and the 50?
Let's see, where are we here? Elementary school, correct. It would be...
I see 67.
67.
67.
851.
2.3. Yeah, Tom, if you look, at the combined under total elementary,
yeah,
it is a 219,590. In the yellow line, combined elementary, 10%. What date are you?
2.8.
You need 222. Throw that one away. It happens every year. It's like...
Yeah, but we have them dated now.
Well, we do. I agree. It happens every year. It's like the different iterations come out, and it migrates throughout the budget cycle. It's like, what?
There hasn't been any changes since the 22nd.
But they're dated, so yep. I can follow it.
Yes.
All right.
And then the other
thing
is...
still a tough pill to swallow.
10% is a tough pill to swallow. Again, wow. That represents...
Huh?
That exceeds our new growth.
Well, and especially, you know, it's...
Just one line.
It's really just kind of keeping their head above water, mm-hmm. too. It's not like they're adding programs mm-hmm. or anything.
Well, know? No, they are.
Well,
they're not adding programs. Well, that's not true, David. They're not adding programs, but they're adding staff.
Yeah, there is a little staff.
Yeah, but you got more kids.
But, yeah, exactly. That's part of the issue.
Well,
and if you look back historically, Tom, at one point, the staff was a lot more than it is there now.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And the population goes
much higher.
Up and down.
I understand.
We're sort of the aberration in the area, too.
Yeah.
We're the only one with it going up.
Yeah.
But they're taking staff also that was being paid on different ways, or taking that and moving them to the budget versus right. through grants.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things that we've always said, at least on the town side, we've been very careful not when usually when there's somebody gets elected and they're tough on crime, they give us money for police that may... You pay the 100% for 2 years or 3 years,
and then it goes away.
And then all of a sudden it goes away, and you can't lose that position.
Well, yes, you can.
Well, something depends on how the grants are written.
I agree.
So we are shifting. The elementary school is actually shifting.
I think it was from choice. They were
increasing. Yeah, increasing. It is increasing staff to play more, to handle more students, but they're shifting some staff from some other monetary sources and putting it back onto the town side of the ledger. So we have to be careful of that. But going up, and I understand they're saying that, of course, the infinite wisdom of the state says that we're not paying our fair share.
Right. That's really the big kicker that got us.
Which are the same people that tell us that we have no affordable housing in town.
Mm-hmm.
But the... rates for affordable the
market housing
is less than their affordable.
Right. Or no protected affordable housing. That's the clincher.
Always a mixed message.
I don't want to
that
start.
little subtext.
You were going
underneath.
Tangential there for a moment.
Well, it's frustrating.
It's frustrating.
Yeah. It's frustrating at times.
With respect to our own administration budget, anything else? The debt piece, if I could.
Oh, sure.
If there's debt that is no longer.
We'll delete it forever.
Yeah.
Okay. I'd like to, we'll do that.
A couple of years makes some sense, but if we have debt that's been retired now for a handful of years, let's mm-hmm. get it off of that. Okay. It's nice to know we paid it off in 2010, but why is it still on the spreadsheet?
How much longer is the library in a public safety building?
I'll have to look. I want to say 12.
That could be up pretty quick, huh?
They're all coming within a decade.
I'll check that.
Yeah.
Just in time for new roofs for the schools and other fun things
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, I agree. But
no, the school doesn't need a new roof, Dave. Dave, the school doesn't need a new roof.
You know what's interesting about that? You look at the other towns, they got the same issues.
Oh, sure.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
To take the discussion, Bruce, about debt and knowing what our capacity to borrow is, there's the Department of Local Services does a nice job, DLS website, what our capacities to borrow are, You know, we have a lot of capacity, but not necessarily a lot of need, and we don't employ that tool that often. So it's nice to know that that capacity is there in the event something is needed. As we talked about large capital pieces, it was a, can we use capital stabilization and fund portions of debt specific to capital? And the answer was yes, we got that from the DOR. So instead of buying $500,000 fire truck, maybe you buy a $500,000 fire truck and you borrow it and you pay it over its life cycle. Anyway, this 10 years ago, we didn't have as much opportunity on that side of the fence because we had multiple schools, a reconstruction, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's good timing, I guess, without getting too deep in the weeds. It's just good timing to say, okay, we've retired a lot of debt proportionate to the town, and now we can think about it more pragmatically. So
the only other thing, Scott, would be the capital request on the administration side, and that would be for the telephone system and some IT improvements. It's about $23,000.
Okay.
We did submit the IT technology grant today.
Yeah.
So if that's funded, we won't have to pay for that on that side. We should be hearing sometime late spring if that grant's funded.
So as we go through that, as we go through the next steps in the budget process, Sherry, probably, I don't know, three meetings.
Mm-hmm.
2 meetings from now, our third meeting, and we can have the draft of the capital.
Okay.
Go through the operating pieces, kind of see what actually starts to make sense. What can we and can we not afford?
You know, another thing about that technology grant, too, is it'll allow us to save money on ongoing phone costs,
going
over to like a VoIP system and everything. So
great points. As part of the grant design, I participated a little bit on the design for the application, and one of the things was VoIP. And the way this phone system is being proposed, it is to be in network and you go right through the phone.
Yep.
One wire, right to the phone, right to your lap, right to your desktop.
Exactly. Just
right in.
The other thing I've been working on is the annual town meeting warrant, and I wasn't sure about when you send out notice to the department heads and the public.
This is beginning of March. We want to have it wrapped up here by the third week of March.
Okay.
So we can warn accordingly.
Okay.
We can open the warrants pretty soon, don't we?
Yeah, I would say we have our drafts out, send notice out to folks who want draft warrant articles, bring the drafts in and open the warrant over the next couple of weeks. So again, this is the first, well, tomorrow's the first. Within 3 weeks, open it up, set the closing date, establish the meeting.
Mark, I stuck a note on the calendar.
There is downstairs calendar-driven piece. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, any board updates?
Speaking of Eversource and energy, we had a lovely little conference Saturday. Steve Kula came over, and that topic was brought up, and then I had a little private chat with him afterwards about it, too. I wanted to try to keep it as productive as possible without it turning into some kind of, complaint session overall. So, you've got to get your thoughts up and stuff like that. But he did a good job of reining in some of the... some folks were really trying to veer over. And it was tough because I think the general topic was renewable energy. So you're covering everything from, wind to solar to pipelines and whatnot. So
looking at it in a holistic discussion?
Exactly. Okay. Right. So a number of us did make our issues known to him, and they'd be getting a letter and so forth. But and he's made a number of good points about the DPU and things like that.
Yeah.
So and he had a lot of good things to talk about on the process of the pipeline and things like that. So it was a very good good topic, and there were a lot of people involved in solar energy in one aspect or another, and had some interesting feedback.
There was a discussion about the tariffs and the caps.
A little bit, yep.
Good.
And then the fact that we're bumping up against them. There was a lot some discussion about the recent Nevada legislation, which I actually happened to bone up on before I went to the meeting. So, and the impact that that could have, potentially. So, it was a good turnout too. The only thing there were a lot. I don't know that the press was there though.
Terrible. Well, you guys were there.
Hey, Al. But, careful.
But not.
Got her eye on you now.
You're not the press, though. You know, because we're public television. Was the
Greenfield Recorder the press?
Were they there? Because I didn't see. I
they were there. Probably would have made a difference anyway, David.
He said tongue in cheek.
I know, right? But it was a great turnout. Fabulous snacks were provided. Yeah,
kitchen garden.
No,
good pastries.
Very good. Yes,
we imported.
That's right. So
he did a very well, very good job handling the crowd.
He did.
Excellent. Did a very good job.
Kept it, and he did a nice job keeping it on focus too.
Yes,
you know,
yes, he did a very good job.
You could, based on some of the questions, you could see how it could veer wildly out of control. So I thought he did an excellent job. It was very informative too. You know,
it had to be like 75 people there.
Oh, it was packed, and there were people out in the.
I was amazed that there were so many people there.
Yep, people from all. We had people from as far west as Clarksburg and. Certainly as far east as Orange, I know that. So, yeah, very good participation. So,
okay. Tom, are we in with any updates?
Senior Center, we have a meeting Wednesday night to talk about the budget and outreach coordinator. Pretty good. The numbers are holding very strong at the Senior Center, so that's good.
Attendance, activities, those kinds of things.
Yep. Actually, they're going to be starting a program very soon with the help of UMass nursing students. So.
Oh, nice.
So it's good. Very good.
Nice.
South County EMS, I think we finished, we did the major portion of the budget. I sent Sherry an email today with some questions about how we need to handle certain things, but she'll give us hopefully Sherry will give us an answer in a few days. So
the mechanics of the town meeting process and what's an article and what's not, those kinds of. Okay, good. Sherry, you've been at it. You got any updates?
The community compact application has been approved.
Congratulations.
Yeah. We're waiting for a signing event. The lieutenant governor.
Is she coming up?
Yeah, I think so. So as soon as I hear about that, I'll let you know. FERCOG also notified us that they've been contracted under the community compact to provide capital planning assistance to the town under the financial management best practices.
Nice.
So Joe Markanian, who used to work with DOR, is now with the FERCOG, and he will be our project manager for that. And we're expecting to start that project the end of April or early May.
Nice.
So, and the IT grant application was submitted today. That project request is a little over $27,000, and we're expecting notification in late spring.
Mm-hmm.
Overlay surplus has been certified by the Board of Assessors for use in fiscal year 17 budgeting. That amount is $39,752.19, and that covers fiscal years 10 through 13.
Oh, good.
That's about it.
All good. Okay. There's a draft. You guys, if the board members take a look. Yeah. Between now and the next meeting about draft agreement for the officer in charge. We also have, the office has been working with officer in charge for schedule completion. And we have, I think, March schedule completion. And looking forward to April, May, June, recognizing, of course, the budgetary constraints, but looking to see what we can do. That said, search committee members, of course, have been notified, and please come in. Have we, as the board, I have to go back and look. When did we say we were going to stop accepting applications?
I believe it's
for the chief? 15th? I'll have to go back and look. Anyway, there's a window that closes, right. And then the whole process starts.
Yep.
Got it. Okay. Anything else? If not, we know there's an election tomorrow, primary election tomorrow at the elementary school from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Again, please pay attention to the ballots as well as your enrollment
really important to have, you know, make sure to get it right.
And please vote.
And please vote.
Well, I would say for those of the yous that say that your vote doesn't matter, you know, you don't have to vote at the general elections, but you should vote at primary elections, right? Because these are, this is where you get to pick the people that stand for general elections. So if you don't like the people standing for general elections, you should be voting in the primary.
Exactly.
Any right. election that you should be voting at primary, because if you're a Democrat, you have a choice. If you're Republican, you have choice. Mm-hmm. I would strongly suggest, and I think both parties would, at least by the number of telephone calls I don't get them.
Both
parties would wholeheartedly support your going out mm-hmm. and actually voting. Because you have choices. Big choices.
Yeah, there are significant
big choices. Probably as diverse choices I've ever seen in an election. Both on both sides. On both sides are big differences.
Yeah. This is, as you said, Tom, the primary piece is one word that one vote carries as much weight as its potential.
Yep. And it is Super Tuesday.
I mean, you got to the winners go on to the final. So if you always say there's nobody to choose from, you go out and vote in the primaries.
Now it's a choice. So next week is a caucus here at 6:30. I see we're also posted for 6:30. Maybe we should post our start time to 7. We get through the caucus piece.
Okay.
Yeah, it usually takes a good half hour.
Yep. And that set up, is there anything else to cover? Lacey, anything else? All right.
Motion.
We have a motion made.
Oh, I guess I'll second.
Dave's in the second. It's time for a cup of hot tea to warm that throat there.
Yeah, I know.
Motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0, please. You can call us out at 7:43. Again, thanks so much.